Blood and Black Rum podcast. I'm Ryan from cultsploitation.com, and I'm joined with my co-host Martin.
How's it going?
We're doing pretty well. I think we missed a week. I think we were supposed to have an episode out last week, and we just didn't get a chance to do it. So apologies to everybody that we didn't actually do the episode last week. But we're back this week with a new one, and we had been promising it for quite a while.
Harley Quinn and the Birds of Prey.
Yeah, that one we have been promising as well, but we did not go out to see that one.
Wait, the Emancipation of Harley Quinn and the Birds of Prey.
Yeah, the long-ass title that they have. No, we don't have that one on the show today. We're fortunate enough to not have had to go out and see that one this time. We might do, I don't know, if it's still in theaters, we might do that for the next episode.
I'm not sure. Pretty sure with how terrible reviews it was getting and the terrible box office it was getting, out. DC might have pulled it
could
out,
be,
you know.
Could be. No, instead, we're doing the Oscar-winning Parasite that we have talked about doing for a little while now. We were going to do it, and then we did Child's Play instead and got pushed back and back, but we're doing it today. So we're doing Bong Joon-Ho's Parasite. Most notable for winning the Best Picture at the Academy Awards. Also, you know, notable for Donald Trump speaking out against it, even though he probably either hasn't seen it or didn't understand it or couldn't read it.
What do you mean I gotta read when I'm watching the movie?
One of those. My guess would be all three. So, you know, obviously, Parasite, big film right now. A lot of people are talking about it. You know, and a lot of times we try to shy away from talking about films like what a lot of people are talking about because, you know, in some ways it's like, how much can you say about a film that hasn't already been said before? But in the case of Parasite, it's, you know, it's so recent that we thought we might as well give it a shot, see what we can pull out of here and talk about, you know, give it the old Blood and Black Rum podcast spin. So we're going to do our best on this one.
Just, you know what? Our dream's going to finally come true next year. We're just fully going to rip off Tim Heidecker and have our On Cinema Oscar, you know, party.
Do a live show for the Oscar party?
Yeah.
Or, you know, yeah, or we could just rip them off in general and just pretend like we know what we're talking about. Just do the whole thing like pretending like we know what we're talking about, but we actually don't. That might, maybe that's how people feel now.
You said that with some certitude that you think we know what we're talking about.
Now we have to prove it.
I got news for you.
Now we have,
Now we belly shallow.
So Parasite from Bong Joon-ho. Big this year, but Bong Joon-ho has actually been a fairly prolific director. He's done quite a few films, Korean films that have been well-received. One of the ones that I known about, I actually have not seen, but I do, I literally have the film, is Sea Fog. He wrote that film. I've gotten it on Blu-ray. I don't know why I haven't watched it yet. I really should do that. So that one resonates with me, stands out, that I've heard of. He's also done The Host, which was a giant kaiju film, you know, about a giant monster rising from the sea. Didn't see that one either, but that one was on a lot of people's radar. Back in 2006 when it came out, you know, not high class cinema, but certainly fun monster movie. And then the big one that he had was 2013 Snowpiercer, which I think was something that people that didn't even really know about Korean cinema actually heard about. You know, in 2013, that was a huge one. They actually were going to do an American remake of it. I don't know if that's still in process or not, but Snowpiercer was one where that really put Bong Joon-ho on the American film scene. And so in 2017, he released Okja. I don't really know that film. I've never even heard of it before. So that one kind of seems like it fell on deaf ears. But 2019's Parasite was when Bong Joon-ho really struck it big in America, getting recognized for the Academy Awards and winning Best Picture. And the one thing that I find kind of ironic is that the Academy nominating Parasite and not realizing, you know, just how ironic it is to have this high class, upper echelon, you know, group of people nominating a film that's about a rich versus poor dynamic.
Yeah, the irony is not lost. But again, as we were saying before we podcasted, it's a very, you know, Academy thing to do to nominate these films that, you know, have him win Best Picture that fall on like deaf ears.
Things that they have like
Dances with Wolves.
And it's also, to me, sometimes...
Crash would be another one.
Crash. The very racially diverse Crash. The thing that really stands out to me about when they nominate and, you know, actually pick these films, too, is that it's almost like a pat on the back from them. They're like, look at us. Look at us recognizing these films that peons will certainly enjoy and relate to. We're great.
I don't think it's that. I think it's just to be like look how artistic and like thought provoking we are.
Mm.
Like, look at the works that we give to the masses. Because again, like most of the films that get nominated are, you know, what we call Oscar bait. You know, like, so you have like films like The King's Speech winning, very dense, you know, films that like. Who went out to ran out and saw The King's Speech in like 2008, 2009 when it came out and ended up winning Best Picture? I'm sure nobody did.
Still haven't seen it. Yeah, I think.
The only reason I was even tempted to see it was because I'm like.
Colin Firth?
No, because it's historic, like, you know, historical and. It was nominated for Best Picture. Mm. So that, you know, other than that, like. Weird. So unless, like, you're like a cinema buff, a lot of the films. You know, especially before they made the field so gigantic now, where they have a dearth of films.
Mm-hmm.
You know, was there like 12 nominated this year?
Something like that, yeah. Yeah, so. Now they just have so many that you're...
Because you're like, oh, it's so hard to choose. Let's just choose them all.
After seeing the film, I love that it seems to spit in the face.
And they were giving out, I think I was reading an article, they were giving out like $5,500 gift bags.
Who were? The Academy?
Yeah, like, if you were there, you got a $5,500 gift bag or something like that.
Sweet.
You know, full of... Or it might have been even more than that, but,
Michael Kors and...
Yeah, it was just, like, ridiculous shit.
Stupid opulence.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about, that it just is really funny that, you know, what this film is about and what it stands for, and then...
Well, the best part, too, was because they always, like, you know, it was great, too, with Ricky Gervais saying, like, don't come up here and fucking, you know, get on your soapbox and... Talk about all your not bullshit. Nobody cares.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody cares. And then you got fucking Joaquin going out there Joaquining, you know, about some vegan bullshit. And then when Pong Hu goes up there, he's just like, I like films. I like to make films. Thank you for giving me the award.
Yeah, thanks. And then thanks for being inspired by all the other directors that were nominated as well.
Not letting, you know... You know, letting his work speak for itself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying you can't go up there and proselytize if you want, but I think at this point a lot of people are fucking sick and tired of, whether you be left or right leaning in Hollywood, what you have to kind of add to the... It's like...
I think the most... Yeah, I think what you... Especially as a director and a writer as Bong Joon-Ho is that you do. You let your work speak for it. It would have been kind of funny if he noted the irony in the whole situation, but, you know...
I think he's just happy to be. He's like, no, I don't want to lose my gift bag.
That's right. And he was going to hit the bar, too. So yeah. He didn't want to be shunned from there. Without even speaking about the film, you know, you can see that its recognition comes from relatability from all kinds of people, all kinds of cultures, not just South Korea where it was made, but. You know, it resonates with America as well. That with the same issues that we're going through right now. It just makes sense that in 2019, Parasite would be the one that would sort of take everybody by storm and really be a film to watch and, you know, diagnose and take apart and just look at the moving pieces and see what it's offering to cinema.
Well, I think an internet, you know, viral camp, you know, word of mouth
mm-hmm.
by the public definitely helped.
Yeah,
because again, sure. If you didn't have that kind of like, hey, you should go see this movie.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way in hell it would have gotten, you know, the recognition. Like, it probably would have won Best Foreign Film, but
right.
It wouldn't have even come close probably to the, you know, Best Picture just because, oh, it's just some little Korean film.
And especially like it's run at various film festivals as well. Mm-hmm. It really helped it with people who are just going to those film festivals. Seeing the movie and they're like bringing it back. They're like, you have to see Parasite. It's amazing. And then again, like I said, Snowpiercer as well helped with Bong Joon-ho's name credit. But definitely people going out there and seeing it and then bringing it back and saying, this is how good it is. You should watch it. Really helped out. All right, let's take a break real quick. We will pause for an advertisement and come back and talk about some beer that we got on the show. Stay with us. So there's a couple things that we can talk about on this episode for beer. We do have some new beer that's on the show. We could also talk about the Saratoga Beer Fest that we just went to this past weekend. So I'll leave it up to you. Do you want to discuss the beer that we have right now, or should we just do the beer fest and talk about that?
We can talk about beer fest.
Okay, we'll do beer fest. So we went to beer fest. We do this every year. I think we've done this for like the past 8 or 9 years, mm-hmm. something like that. I have the glasses to prove it because they give you a new glass each year. So I'm sure that if I needed to, I could go back and count each different glass that I have.
Yeah, I've broken like 4 of them.
I still have them all. So
I wish. Well, a couple of them, like other people, like broke, but just, mm-hmm. I think I got like 5 of them.
Yeah. So we do this every year. We go with friends and hang out at this beer fest and just have, you know, 15, 16 different beers over the course of 3 hours. And, we get a lot of different breweries that come out, some local, some bigger names like Rogue and Dogfish Head that come and just dish out their beers. Sometimes they're in like a cooler keg that they pour from. Sometimes they literally have kegs that are in a tap. And just a really fun time that we have trying out things that we wouldn't normally try out, like buying for ourselves. For example, Founders was there. And they had their KBS espresso on tap there.
Which, by the way, kudos to them for bringing 5 different beers mm-hmm. and having them all on tap.
Yeah, it's great.
One thing that's got kind of grinding my gears over the past couple of years, they've more and more of these breweries are becoming shoddy and just shipping, you know, having cans and them pouring them out instead of, you know.
No, I agree. That is,
it's called America on Tap.
That's true. I also do not like it when they just bring a bunch of cans or something, because you could do that any time.
Yeah.
I mean, I could buy a can.
I expect that if I go test then. I expect if I go to like my local beer beverage center and you're like, hey, we're sampling this, crack it open, try it. Not
right.
You know.
Right. Right. I agree. But yes, you're right. Founders did bring 5 different beers, and one of them, which I was very surprised that they actually brought on tap, was the KBS Espresso. And if you've seen KBS Espresso in stores or anything like that, you'll know a 4-pack runs you about $24.
Any of their KBSs run, you know.
Pretty much any of those. Any the CBS, the KBS, the KBS Espresso, any of those, about $24 for a 4-pack. So that's not really something that I normally show out the money to buy just for myself for a 4-pack. So I wanted to try it, and so I got it there, the KBS Espresso. So it's a chance for us to try stuff that we wouldn't otherwise go out of our way to try. And I guess I'll focus on the things that I like the most there. The KBS Espresso was okay. I like the KBS more than the KBS Espresso. I felt that the coffee flavor was not super pronounced, so I would like it to have a little bit more coffee flavor to it. But still not too bad. My favorites actually tended to be more of the Gose's that were on tap. I'm not a huge sour fan, but I was tasked with finding some great sours there by my wife, who loves sours and couldn't make it because we have kids now. And so I tried a whole bunch of sours for her. And it was just strange that the ones that I liked the most at the show were sours. One of them was... Two Roads, which is a fairly local brewery to us. Two Roads, they make a tanker truck, and it's called, and it is a lime sour.
Persian lime.
Persian lime sour. I don't know if the Persian makes a huge difference, but...
or as I said, Parisian lemon.
Yeah. That one has almost a margarita-like flavor to it. The lime and the saltiness to it. Really pronounced this margarita flavor that I found to be very refreshing, especially in a sea of double IPAs and tropical IPAs and hazy IPAs.
And imperial stouts.
And imperial stouts. So the lime sour was very, very good for me. And then the other one that I really enjoyed was another local brewery. You've probably heard us talk about them, Druthers. They make what's called the Dare. and that's their traditional sour. But then they also do experimental batches of the dare, where they try different fruits in that sour.
I think the passion fruit one's the one they have out in four packs.
Yes, they do. The passion fruit one is like another one that they're, you know, that's become more of their main style. But the one that they had at the show was their blueberry dare. So it was a blueberry sour, and I found that one just delectable.
It was good, because, you know, you thought I didn't like it because you think I don't like blueberry. I love blueberry. I just hate artificial blueberry. And this tasted like blueberries and not like artificial blueberry.
It had a fantastic blueberry flavor.
And it was bright, like Veruca Salt blueberry blue. Yeah. You know.
And one thing that I was saying is that a lot of times sours, no matter what fruit you put in the sour, it all tends to taste the same, a tarty, sour beer.
There was one that was just that, which was the Dogfish Head Super 8, which was just double, you know, double goes. Which...
And I had another one, too, that was a stone fruit beer. And, again, same thing. It just, all of that stuff, whatever fruit you're using, this kind of morphs into this one very samey, sour flavor. And so the reason why I liked both the Tanker Truck Lime Sour and the Blueberry Sour is because they have distinctive sour taste to them rather than just a, you know, a mashup of various fruits that taste sour. So those were my big two that I really enjoyed at the show that day. I had about 16, I would say.
I think we had more, but I think the internet by the end was starting to get a little shoddy. So.
I know that I tracked 16. And I would say those two are definitely my favorite. And what about you?
Surprisingly, the Persian Lime from Two Roads was my favorite. I'm not the biggest sour fan, but that was the perfect, like you said, it's like a margarita. It's like the perfect blend of having a juicy, tart limeness to it, a little bit of saltiness to it. I don't know if they had actually like sea salt in it, but it definitely felt like it had hints of it, and like it had a nice pucker at the end, you know. It all was balanced incredibly well. I loved it to death, and it's a sour I would definitely go out of my way to get all the time because it's just quenching. Great. Another one, Rogue had a rhubarb strawberry sour. Mm-hmm. And I've never had rhubarb before. Gave it a shot. Pretty damn delectable. Liked it a lot. Wasn't really that sour at all. Had a nice strawberry taste to it. It was almost like a bright pink, like a Nesquik strawberry milk mix. Definitely would say that was really good. Let's see. The Pabst Hard Coffee.
Mm.
That was, you know, surprisingly pretty good.
That's right.
As our friend described it, Hody said it was like kind of like drinking Yoo-Hoo. Kind of was, kind of had that consistency, that mouthfeel, with a slight coffee taste to it.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say that was good. I would definitely actually drink that, you know, quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, really, to be honest with you, there weren't really any, like, particular IPAs that were sticking out to me.
I didn't really have a huge standout.
Like, Rare Form had, like, their Moxie Double IPA. That was just all right.
Rogue had a pretty good New England IPA.
I had, like, you know, the Druthers, No Headphones at NYPA. That was just literally just all right.
Hey, let's go with, so what were the letdowns of the show this year?
Besides the Bud Light Seltzer?
Yeah, besides that.
I don't know, the Saranac Legacy was definitely...
Yeah, I was going to say that. The Saranac Legacy, if 2.0. You haven't heard, Saranac has a new Legacy. It's called the version 2.0. And, I don't really, I mean, I guess I'd have to taste them right back to back, but again, the Legacy IPA 2.0 tastes like exactly what you would expect a West Coast IPA to taste like.
The Galaxy Bomb by Sloop was pretty disappointing too. Mm. And Sloop does make very good NYPAs.
Mm-hmm.
Disappointed that Omegang leaving early.
Disappointment.
A great disappointment. In fact, kind of infuriating.
They did still have a... like one beer that was on tap after they left, but their actual station was completely deserted after an hour, which is crazy. And especially because there's another show after this one. So do they just not go to that second, where they just like, nah, fuck it. We're heading back to Cooperstown. Fuck it.
It was just like, I don't
know. Weird. I don't know why they were gone.
Sam Adams didn't even show up. They didn't even try.
Like, I don't, yeah, I didn't see them at all.
They were kind of like, fuck this. Nope.
I'll tell you what, one of my disappointments, the Ama Gang Double Merlot. I don't know if it's just because of how many beers I had had at the show or how my palate was fucked up.
A nice
up.
Wine beer doesn't really sound like to be too palatable.
But the whiny double was very hard to drink.
You even like the double, like the Abbey?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, I have to be in the mood for it. I'm not like always like, give me a double. You know, going to the bar. I'll take, you know how some people in movies go to the bar, like, I'll take a beer. I go to the bar and I go, I'll take a double. I'll take a triple.
Well, that's our friend. Well, I'll say that's our friend Hody, who absolutely goes apeshit over the Three Philosophers.
So I'm not like that anyway. But yeah, for whatever reason, at the show specifically, that double Merlot really hit me as being very difficult to drink. I have to try it like with a clean, cleansed palate after I've eaten a bunch of coffee beans or something, just to see if it was actually the beer itself or just me being 14 deep and like, ugh, I can't do anymore. Because you do get to a point at the end of the show where you're like,
all right, yeah,
nothing sounds good.
Well, because we were like looking, like, we're like,
yeah,
Mill One has a, has, you know, the Kolsch.
Yeah, right.
All right. Yeah. Walt Whitman had a pale ale. All right.
You're looking for something else. And you're, you know, when you have that sea of IPAs, you get to the point where you're like, I don't think I can do anymore.
I think that's IPAs. Why they bring, like, those are the smart brewers. They're like, no, we're going to bring.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to bring something light and effervescent. That way, you know, when everyone's like, oh, I'm fucking bloated from all these double IPAs, come have a Kolsch.
That is hard at the end of the show, and you're like, oh.
I was disappointed Wolf Hollow wasn't there.
Not that we saw. We didn't see them,
No,
right?
They weren't there. Because we walked, we did like four laps around.
Yeah, I definitely did
they
not
weren't
notice
there.
Them.
Yeah.
Was Browns there?
Nope.
Didn't see Browns there either.
Wait. They were, I think. Yeah, they were.
Were they? Huh. We just didn't get to them, I guess.
That oat stout that our buddy had, that was really good. That oatmeal stout, I can't remember who made it, but...
Yeah, I can't remember who made that one.
That was really good. Mm-hmm. Puts Browns to shame.
It was a good one. And but I like Browns. I like Browns oatmeal stout.
I haven't had it in years, to be honest. I've kind of, like, kind of grown... You know, grown past it. Surprisingly, the Natty Light Mango Peach Aloha Breeze Hard Seltzer wasn't bad
at
all.
That was pretty good. That was pretty... I would drink that. For sure.
I didn't have
the expected terrible aftertaste that I was
which the Bud Light seltzer did, which is funny.
I didn't have the Bud Light seltzer. You got conned into it. The guy hardcore was like, you gotta have some of this.
No, he didn't. But well, when I was walking by, he did for the Natty Light. He was upselling it.
Yeah, right.
But for the Bud Light seltzer, when we walked by, he was just like, it was like at a ball game. Like, Bud Light seltzer, get your Bud Light seltzer.
And you're like, how can I pass this
And
up?
I was like, well, I'm not, I don't, I know they have them at Tall Boys now, at Stewart's now, so I was like in a couple of flavors. So I was like, yeah, you know what? I'll try. And it had the awful aftertaste, which is funny because Natty Light's the lowest tier Anheuser-Busch brand. Bud Light's your flagship, and your fucking flagship version tastes like shit compared to the Natty Light version.
Mm-hmm.
I would try that. I want to try the Catalina Lime Mixer now.
Catalina Lime.
Because that cherry lime just sounds like a delightful hard seltzer.
I just like the word Catalina.
I just love the Step Brothers reference.
It's true.
They should have Fred Armisen, John C. Reilly, and
Bill Hader.
Will Ferrell on there for, and Bill Hader.
It's true.
Get both those the Catalina Breeze and the Catalina Wine Mixer in.
All right, so anything else that you want to talk about Beer Fest before we move on? Do Parasite?
No. Do you want to talk about the Tim and Eric show?
We can a little bit. I mean, it's... Sure. We can.
Look, it doesn't have to be related to the podcast. It was just a great time.
That's true.
We did go see Tim and Eric live.
We did.
Probably never going to happen again.
It was a fun time.
It's their last tour.
So, supposedly. the last tour. Yeah.
Sponsored by Boot Barn.
It was a really fun time. It's a cool venue anyway. The Egg is a cool venue. No bad seats, even though I bought... You know, what I thought were going to be terrible tickets. There's no bad seats in there. And
but no, I'm pretty sure the closer you, because it's such a smaller amphitheater, the closer you are, the kind of shittier it would probably be. So
that's true. Yeah. And just a fun, interactive show. Extremely funny. I was crying like the first minute into the show. Definitely recommend going to see it.
The playbill was hilarious. It's awesome. Amazing.
I don't really want to talk too much about it because I don't want to ruin the experience.
No, I know, but I'm just saying some thoughts. Like, what, like, because as much as we both love Tim and Eric, it'd be going in, we're kind of like, well, how the hell are you gonna?
Yeah, how are you gonna do a 2-man show? You know, live like that. Yeah, it's great. I definitely recommend checking that out and going to see it. Really funny.
If you see the ad, you have to go. It's the mandatory.
That's right. It's mandatory.
Yeah.
And also, you know, it depends on if you like that style of humor. But if you do, it is very funny. Extremely funny.
Listen, as long as they keep Vic Berger with employment,
that's right. That's true. He's one of the stars of the show, and he's not even there.
And it was on Valentine's Day, so that was nice for us.
That's right. Nice little Valentine's Day date.
And people were proposing on stage at the end.
Yep.
Hacks.
I hope they filmed at least one show as like a...
Oh, I'm sure they did.
Release it later. They haven't filmed the other live shows that they've done. At least not that they've been released.
I'm sure they'll film something because they were showing clips from like previous...
yeah, they did. Yeah. They didn't release like an official... show from their previous live performances.
Well, I don't think they'll do that, but I think they'll tape some of it.
Yeah. A lot of fun. Definitely check it out if it comes around you. It's awesome. All right. Let's get into Parasite. We got a lot to talk about on the show. I even wrote down some notes. So, like I said, we're being journalistic today. And
ruining the formula of being off
the cuff.
Off the cuff.
So where should we begin? We really don't need to do a synopsis so much because the synopsis is sort of crazy. I don't know. It would sound all over the place if you really tried to synopsize the film itself. But I will start off by saying that Parasite is, for what it's worth, what I knew about the film, it morphs quite a bit throughout the movie from where I thought it, what I thought it was, to what it becomes later on.
I was hoping halfway through the film, when we get that one reveal, that... it would turn into like a stereotypical like Japanese like Korean like horror like you know
yeah
ghost horror thing.
It kind of, in some ways, it does seem like that is going to be the case. I think the reveal that you're talking about is actually when we find out about the basement,
mm-hmm.
and there is that whole scenario where they're running through the basement and it's a small corridor of in a series of tunnels that go down into the basement. Where it looks like we're in, like, a grudge movie or something like that. And there's even characters that kind of creep around on their, you know, hands and knees, like, going around the stairwell. And it does almost seem like that's sort of an homage to some of those films that have done that previously in you know, like, J and K horror. But at the same time, like, I find that Parasite morphs very well within each of its respective, like, elements that it tries to recreate. So you have, like... I know that some people like to think of, and I wouldn't say they do, but Parasite in a lot of ways has really captured the horror genre market, even though it's not really a horror film. It's not, it doesn't fit in that wheelhouse at all. If anything, it's more of a thriller, and I would even call it a black comedy, a dark comedy in some ways. And so, but it's interesting that it has impacted the horror community in so many ways, even to the point where a lot of people were very excited to see it win the Academy Award because it was technically a small crumb of a horror film that won the award. I don't really see it that way, but I think
just from like the visual aspects, the like color palette and like just certain things with the film like creates a tenseness that you would hope to feel in a very good horror film.
Right, right.
And I think because the horror community outside of like a couple of films these days is starved for great tension. The fact that this film has a bunch of that great tension in it, kind of like, no, that's one of ours.
Yeah. You're kind of, yeah, you're like,
because it's definitely, I would definitely say it's more of a black comedy and slightly a thriller. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say it's like, oh, it's downright, you know, like thriller, but it's got aspects of it. I definitely think he borrows from a lot of genres You know, like a slice of life, black comedy, regular comedy, you know, drama, all these things.
Crime.
Like, yeah, crime, to create this gigantic, you know, melting pot of a film.
And like I said, it really runs the gamut. And its plot, the storyline that Bong Joon-ho has written, is sort of like, I guess if you were to see it on paper, you'd be like, that's all over the place. Like, there's... What is happening in this movie? Like, how can they run through all of that stuff in the same movie? But it works extremely well. And it just, you know, it's just one thing after another. Not in the same way of, we talked about, I'm trying to think of a movie that had this where we said it was just one thing after another. I recall we just did it not too long ago, a movie that was like that, but I can't remember it now. But there are films that, like, well, I guess I'll say Fury Road, which is literally like
breakneck.
One thing after
just,
another.
Just go, go.
Bam, 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 bam. Parasite's not like that, and I don't want it to sound like it's frenetic or like kinetic or anything like that. It's actually a fairly slow-moving film, but the way that it morphs is sort of very fluid in that it's going...
It makes it feel like it's frenetic.
It does, exactly.
Like that everything's going bang, 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 because it's just the way it's... Just building and building and building until you get to the end where it's just this giant fucking, you know, release of energy.
I feel like if you were just to try to explain this in its most basic generalities and say, yeah, it's about a family who infiltrates a rich people's family and becomes workers in that family. And then they find some people in the basement that have been living there for some time. And then those people kind of go crazy and they all attack the family. It's really hard to just summarize that in a way that makes sense and sounds like it could, you know, have any artistic merit. But then when you just watch it and you see it develop and fluidly go from scene to scene and event to event, it just happens and it works. And it's surprising in the method that Bong Joon-ho uses to get from one destination to another, and yet still maintain a lot of the themes that he has put in the film since the beginning. And also going back to things that he's mentioned just briefly within the film's realism. For example, people saying how hot it is outside, and then later on an open window becomes a huge issue for the family. Or, you know, just seeing light switches go off and then later on it makes a more meaningful element to the film. Those types of things where you return to those small details are what really makes a movie something to think about rather than just kind of be there observing.
Mm-hmm.
You're in it, and it becomes more realistic because of that. So I think that's really interesting, and that's kind of where I wanted to start, is just talking about how the plot moves and the way that Bong Joon-ho structures the movie to move from one destination to another and how that shifts over time. I think that the one thing that really stuck out to me about the way that this moves is you have that really – that first initial structure of this family who's the family who's trying to infiltrate the Park family. They've now found out, oh, okay, these people are pretty rich.
They're the Korean shameless.
That's right, yeah. They're pretty rich, and they could definitely use some help. And we are those people that can give that help to them as long as we get the other people that are in those positions out of those positions, and we can all be a part of this, you know, syndicate that's behind the scenes.
It's because they have a job. How about we get those jobs?
Yeah, exactly.
You know.
Yeah, it's like...
I think the cleverness to the film is they kind of... And I don't know if you'll agree with me or not. For a good chunk of the film, if you were to kind of take the film at, like, just face value, it seems like the Kim family is completely malicious. So you get, like, up until, like, halfway through the film, where, like, the basement starts to get introduced.
Mm-hmm.
It's... Their poverty is more of a characteristic of their life than like an actual thing that you can kind of say with the way they act. If you were like just weren't really thinking about the film, like, well, these people are scumbag assholes. But as the film goes on, you kind of see how the life that they've lived is creating all these, how they're acting, and, you know, and then being surrounded in, you know, the rich atmosphere and the dichotomy it creates and their attitude towards them. And how, like, again, it's, like, slowly building. Like, again, like you said, if you just were to, like, watch the first, like, half hour of this film, you're like, these guys are just a bunch of assholes. You know, being like, oh, like, your buddy tells you about this good, you know, job of, you know, lecturing her daughter. You know, like, teaching her English.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's like, instead of being like, oh, that's a good way to make money. Our family's down in the dumps. We need to make money. You know, he's thinking about, gotta get the sister in on this. And then gotta get the dad, like, get everybody in on it. So, again, it's not, like, coming from the perspective of, like, they're just looking for work. It's like, how can they, you know, it's like a con game. Which they don't, like, explicitly say that they're trying to con them, but it's that's how it comes. So, I think that's, like, a really interesting aspect, watching how that goes. Because, again, at first it seems like these people are trash.
Mm. I think I found it. I kind of went back and forth on that. So I think that Bong Joon-ho does a really good job at the beginning of the film of showing
their environment that they're
in. Yeah, the environment and what they're living in and what, you know, what they go through on a day-to-day basis that makes them think this way. And so you can kind of understand where they're going, where they're coming from in that, you know, especially because they do have qualities that make them that should make them successful people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they talk about how much the father has worked in different fields, and he's very varied in all the fields that he's worked in. He's been attempting many things, and they happen to fail. Or you have the son who is actually really good at English tutoring. He's good at tutoring in general,
mm-hmm.
and you know he's still not able to get the opportunities that he should be getting. Or the fact that the daughter is really, really, really good at art. And yet, she should be going to college with it, but she doesn't have any opportunity to go there. So you kind of do get that.
You're right. You do see that. But my point is, like, it's kind of like it's, for the most part, it's, you know, it's very, like, if you're not paying attention, it's very, those types of things, like, very quick, you know, if you're not, you know, being attentive while you're watching the film.
Yeah.
You know, I think those things, and I think that's intentional, too, because it's kind of to plant the seed there, but not have you, like, be focused on, like, well, you know, about that. That's not what you're trying to focus on when you're originally looking at these people.
I definitely felt I was going back and forth between them. Like, you know, sometimes I felt like, yeah, they're, you know, they're just doing the best that they can. They're trying to make the best of a bad situation. And so, in some ways, they're making bad decisions. But it's for the, you know, for the good of their family. And then at the same time, Bong Joon-ho also introduces a lot of different scenes that make you think otherwise. You're like, maybe not. There's that whole scene where the family goes out on a camping trip. And so the Kim family starts to just trash everything in the house that they just grab all their food, start eating everything in there.
Get drunk
on their very expensive whiskeys, you know, just throw things on the floor willy-nilly. And so then you're like, well, you know, maybe they're, you know, yeah, they did mean well at first, or they were just trying to make ends meet, but now they're not really, you know, being respectful. So you kind of go both ways throughout a lot of the film.
And you're right to bring up the whole, you know, they're trying their best, because that's a theme that gets brought up several times between, you know, Kim and Park, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like they're both, even though one's, you know, has wealth and one is impoverished, they're both, you know, trying their best.
Mm-hmm.
But again, like at first when you're, you know, watching the Kim family constantly bringing up, like, them, like, how they're acting and, like, you know, how to act and, like, how, like, again, like, they're preparing that whole script of, like, this is how we get, you know, this person fired so you can become the housekeeper.
Right, I mean, it's literally a con.
Yeah,
and they say you should have been a con then, but that's literally what it is, especially when you're scripting things out.
Yeah, you know, so, I mean, like I said, it's understandable to sit there like, well, they are, you know, just trying to get by, but at the same time, it's like, they're just trying to get by and then, like, you know, what they're doing 70% of the time is, you know, very it's not great that what mm-hmm. they're doing. It's, right. You know, because their tricks and scams to get to the jobs that they're getting is getting these
other
what
people,
we know,
other good people.
You know, fired, and then they're possibly going to be leading a life of, poverty because of that. So,
right. Yeah. And it's really crazy, especially because that all harkens back to the theme of these poor people against poor people throughout quite a bit of the film, where you have the rich people who are quite literally having a grand old time living above ground in their regular house, a beautiful, expansive, architecturally designed house. And then you have people living in squalor down, literally down flights and flights of stairs, which we see in this really great shot of Bong Joon-ho following the family as they escape from the rich people of the Kim's house, going down these stairs and stairs and stairs and stairs all the way down into their squalorly living area where sewage is seeping into their basement. And that scene of stairs is really nice. That is one of the elements of that you were talking about, the tension of the film, that really stands out as a very tense moment in, you know, what has otherwise been a pretty dark comedy. Of them, it's pouring out. You know, it's just been raining all day, running down stairs that you see are getting increasingly more flooded, and then finally getting back to their sub-basement, which they've found to be completely submerged in water.
Sewage water.
Sewage water, saving whatever precious items that they can find in their sewage water. It's a pretty harrowing moment, especially because it then juxtaposes back to the next day where the Park family is like, we're going to have a great party for our son. We're going to just go all out and buy, you know, tons of wine and food and cheeses and all that shit.
Hors d'oeuvres.
Yeah, invite all of our friends. Have a violinist and a opera singer there. And so there's that juxtaposition of like, yeah, the Kim family has to get up and get out and go to this great party after their entire house has been washed out. And they've been living in a gymnasium for the entire night. That's a moment that really stands out as, you know, yes, it's a dark comedy, it's a black comedy, but that part of it is really, you know, harrowing.
No, I agree. That whole sequence of them trying to get out of the house undetected, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great.
It's like a nice, you know, 20-minute long slow build, you know.
Yep.
You know, just growing tension, and it's the scene takes different, you know, twists and turns that you wouldn't expect, you know.
Yeah, there's I really like the way that they shot that, because you have like that very expansive living room that they're in, and it seems like they should have really no big deal getting out of the living room and getting downstairs and getting out of the house, and yet there's that really big nice twist of the kid waking up and the light coming on and the walkie-talkie going on. And then you have that very expansive wide shot again of them looking out this nice view window.
Into this backyard, yeah.
That's nicely framed and symmetrical. Mm. And then the father's feet that are just off to the left-hand side of the shot, you know, just laying there, hoping not to be noticed.
Kind of reminded me of a Wes Anderson shot, the way that, you know, that giant, you know, window door, and like the kid being out in the tent, like it was like making me think of like Moonrise Kingdom or some shit.
Right,
you know?
Right.
Like, you're like, oh, you know. Yeah. Let's talk about the Park family.
Okay.
You know, getting more into, you know, detail about, you know, who they are, mm-hmm. what they do, and who they are.
At first I thought the wife was going to be the stereotypical, like, unhappy wife. She's really rich, but still unhappy. Because that first shot that we see of her is her, like, kind of, like, laying on the table outside with her head mm-hmm. down. And then she comes inside. And then it actually kind of morphs away from that. She's not really an unhappy wife or anything like that. She's actually extremely happy. Just gullible. Just extremely gullible.
Naive.
Yeah.
I would say the whole family's naive.
And I think it's
you know, I think a good metaphor, you know, for showing like, you know, people who have more wealth than they know what to do with mm-hmm. are going to be naive to the problems of people who are impoverished, because how the fuck would they know?
Right. Not only naive about how people are impoverished, but just naive in general about how life works. Like in this case, there's a nice shot of, and it's really quick, of the woman, the mother in the Park family, trying to get her dishwasher, everything out of it. And she's just struggling with it. And that's a really quick shot as she's on the phone. And yet you can tell, you know, this family, that they're just not accustomed to doing things that normal people would do. Just normal everyday folks would actually, and a lot of people don't even have a dishwasher. So, you know, for them to struggle with just even getting dishes out of a dishwasher just shows that they're not accustomed to the problems that most people would have. And the other thing that you see a lot is that
I think the fact too that she's willy nilly like paying for all these, like, yeah, you be the art therapist and you pay right.
Just, you know, taking them at their face value.
Yeah, it's like, oh yeah, you know, because why the hell do I gotta care? It's just money. It's just money. Wee, mm-hmm. you know, without being like, because if like me or you would be like, oh, you're gonna tutor our daughter. Like, all right, well, so what the fuck do you do? How much do you want? No. You know, not just being like, yeah, sure, whatever.
And the other thing too is, what they actually bring it up in this in the part of the film when the Kim father is driving Park, and he says, you know, I can hire another housekeeper, no problem. The thing is, they mention multiple times is like they don't even want to talk to the people about the problems that they think are going on, like the driver having, they think he's having sex in his car, or the housekeeper who they think has tuberculosis. They don't even want to bring it up with them because it's so much easier for them to just fire and rehire.
Give him a nice severance, yeah, move on.
That they don't even bother to do that type of thing, and that's why they're so gullible, because they're not doing any, they're not vetting at all. They're not, there's no background checks, there's no looking up art therapy to see if it's full of shit. They're just literally hiring whatever they think they need. And so you do get that where, it, you know, in life experience, the Kims are much more hardy and prepared for real life than the Park family. And so that's another juxtaposition between the two of them.
I do think it's kind of, I don't know if it would have worked with either one of the husband and wife being kind of this way, but I think the film could have also benefited from also having kind of like a malicious part of like, so like somebody, like maybe it was like a friend of theirs or somebody who was wealthy who had like a malicious streak to them. Because again, like I said, like the first, you know, from what we see from the Kims for a good chunk, you know, for a good portion of the film is, you know, they're conning them. And how, you know, how they're trying to benefit. And I think the fact that they're just kind of showing these rich people as just, you know, naive to everything that doesn't go on in their little circle, I think is kind of a missed opportunity.
Well, I think that's intentional. I think that what we're supposed to be seeing at the beginning is that, yes, the Kims are sort of being, you know, they're scoundrels. They're getting into, they're infiltrating this, and they're becoming literally the parasite of the title. But then as you get through, and you at first you think, oh, the, you know, the Parks really aren't that bad. You know, yeah, they might be gullible, they not, might be naive, and they might, you know, not really think too much of their associates, where they'll just hire and fire willy-nilly. But they're not that bad of people, and they don't really seem like they don't have respect for the Kims. However, as that moves forward, you get little glimpses of how they don't respect, you know, people who they feel are under them. And that the biggest one is when Kim brings up the, or Park brings up the fact he's that the Kim over. Father has a smell about him that he notices. And he says, you know, he sometimes he, when he's speaking, he nearly crosses the line, but he doesn't cross the line, but his smell crosses the line. And so that little snippet right there is your first glimpse as the viewer, where you're like, whoa, you know, and also for the Kims, really, that you're like, whoa, okay. So the part, you know, the Parks, for all they show that they, you know, don't seem superior, they feel it. They feel superior on the inside, and they may not speak it.
I understand that. I'm saying there also could have been an opportunity though, to have somebody who's kind of just like more downright malicious. Because again, I think, you know, because I think this film does a great job of showing like everybody's like colors, and I do think you're right. It does a great job in showing like, yeah, they have these, you know, the Parks, even though they seem like, oh, they're nice, there is like an affront to it, because when they're like kids out in the tent, they're out, you know, fucking giving hand jobs and handsies while, you know, saying
reach arounds,
you know, tell me, you know, tell me I sell drugs, you know, because that's what they're accusing, you know, of the driver of. And like, you know, what if I got those cheap panties for you to wear? That'd get me off, you know. So, yes, I get all that. But I'm saying I'm not saying it's totally necessary, but I think it could have benefited, too, from having somebody who's kind of a little bit more outright malicious. Because, again, like I said, the film does such a good job of showing all these different, you know, colors. I think that's like kind of a missed opportunity because to say like that, you know. It's all just a front. There are rich people that, you know, who are just outwardly miserable cunts. And miserable cunts to poor, you know, to, you know.
I feel like, you know, what they didn't want to do is be a little too cliche on, you know, because a lot of representation of rich people in films is like, oh, they're miserable cunts and they're assholes and stuff like that. You know, snobby, you know, richy rich people.
I'm not saying being like, you know, Dick Dastard, like, but I mean, you know.
But I think the intent was maybe to just not go the super stereotypical route like that. But, yeah, I mean, you could have the malicious people. I like that they did do a nuance to the Kim, or to the Park family, at least, where there was that one part where you're like, wow, you know. So that's what they think.
Well, I think it's even better. I think it's even better when, like, she was like, "What smell are you talking about?" You know, after they're done having their reach around fun.
Yeah.
And then she's in the car next day. She's got her fucking bare feet just... you know, on the passenger seat, you know, kicked up as she's on the phone, and then you see a girl. And I'm like, oh,
right,
it does smell like old radishes.
Yeah, it's an interesting reveal for them because, like I said,
and you could see his face too because he was there when they were talking about it, and you could see his face, like, you know.
And Kang Ho Sun is really great in these moments where they're talking about his smell. Because he really does have a very good facial. He can't say anything in both of those scenes. Because in the one, he's under a table, trying to be quiet. And then the other, he's just driving her, so he can't, you know. He notices, but he can't say, like, stop sniffing me. But in both of those, you can just see the facial reaction of him being, like, both hurt, upset, you know, angry, all of those things. Because in a lot of ways, that's a smell of a person doing what they can, right? Like living life in the way that the only way that they know how and coping. And something that the Park family would just not understand. You know, the Park is he certainly is somebody who works hard, but he's a businessman. And it's a very different thing than having a completely, you know, manual lifestyle like the Kings do. I mean, they all of their work is manual labor, basically.
And they were folding pizza boxes.
So I think that's, you know, that's really interesting how that comes out. And it's just a very, you know, a very upsetting scene, especially with how he reacts to that phrase that they use that comes up again and again later on in the film. One thing that I did want to talk about is that metaphor of the rock that is within this movie. A rock that is presented to them early on in the movie. It's like a big, you know, boulder, basically. And then it becomes sort of like a weight throughout the rest of the movie as the family remembers that they have this rock and it's supposed to bring them wealth. That's the metaphor behind it, that, you know, it's a nice rock that Min's grandfather had. Gives it to them. It's supposed to, it's basically a good luck charm. It's supposed to bring wealth. And it's almost like the idea of your American dream, right? That you have this American dream. You can achieve anything. You know, you can, whatever you put your mind to.
Just pull yourself up.
Bootstraps. Work really hard. You'll achieve your wealth. You'll get rich. And you'll get whatever you want. And so that's like the rock in this movie. And it's actually becomes a weight that weighs them down, thinking about that. Especially because it's literally the demise of one character. It then at the end, it also becomes a part of a, I guess you call it a dream sequence or a wish fulfillment sequence where they put the rock back. So what did you think about the rock in this movie? The metaphor. Not Dwayne Johnson.
No, that's The Rock. Not the metaphor. I like it. It's good. I definitely liked it, the how poor Kevin gets bashed in the head with it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's a good explicit moment that we don't
know. And the fact that they even showed him grabbing the rock again and getting slammed in the head again for good measure, you know, that's was unexpected and, you know, kind of got a chortle out of me, you know.
Surprising that he's overall fine at the end of the movie, though. Kevin, after being bashed in the head with this.
It was kind of reminding me of, like, the end of Clockwork Orange where, you know, he got him, like, in the hospital bed and he's just kind of laughing and daydreaming off. But. I think it's a good metaphor because the Park family have their own metaphor for wealth about the ghost in the house. You know, that's supposed to create wealth. And I think you're right. It's supposed to be used as a good luck charm because at first he's very, kind of like, going to hold on to this as, you know, something that's going to turn our luck around. And that's, you know, when he. By getting that from Min, he also gets that job, and then by doing that, he's also, you know, they're all able to eventually infiltrate the Park family, and that's creating their wealth at the time.
Yeah, I forgot about that, too, that they used the man in the basement as the ghost that's supposed to be good luck for them, for wealth.
Mm-hmm.
That's another same idea, metaphor. I forgot about that, that was something else that they used
as metaphor. Because they were talking about how their son saw a ghost when he was sitting down after his, like, first grade birthday party, slovenly eating cake on the floor. You know, just like, and they saw, you know, somebody pop out from the basement.
That's interesting because it's another misplaced idea. It's, you know, it has nothing to do with metaphor or luck or wealth. It's actually another person that is struggling living in their basement because they literally have nothing else and they have to live in the basement because debt collectors, or I guess in this case, Korean loan sharks, are coming after them. That's the reason why he's living in this family basement. For 4 years. Basically just stealing some of the food so that he can eat and coming out whenever they're not there. And that leads us really into the
which that's also a nice touch I like, too. Because they add in, like, well, like, what the hell is this bunker down here? Like, most people, these rich houses have bunkers just in case, you know, there's ever an attack from North Korea.
Predators.
Yeah. Which, harkens back to, like, especially in American terms, to, like, Cold War, you know, mm-hmm. America-Soviet, like, the idea of, like, have your bunker on ready just in case the Soviets ever attack.
Right.
You know, and if you think about it, at least in modern terms for us over here, it's not really the same in South Korea. I mean, you know, they're always on high alert over there because war could ever be imminent between the two. But at least for us, that idea of, like, have a bunker on standby because there might be a giant attack is a ghost of an idea. That's like something from far, you know, 60, 70 years ago.
Right. Yeah.
So that's like, you know,
some people still have freestanding bunkers, but it's not something that you worry about on a day to day basis.
So that kind of juxtaposition was kind of nice, you know, seeing that. Cause it's like, you know, just from being an American and knowing, you know, a little bit of history, it's like, oh, you know, that's kind of, you know, an idea that wouldn't resonate with, it would only resonate with, like, baby boomers at this point, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting, too, because it's not the only time that they bring up nuclear warheads.
Yeah.
There's a whole element to it where the Kims sort of are pretending like they're being a news forecast about nuclear warheads that are being...
It's the old housekeepers doing, like, the North Korean news, which was pretty spot on, because I've seen, like, you know, like, the North Korean, like, news, like, things, and she's like, you know, like, this is, you know, speaking bombastically about using the nuclear warheads to spread peace, you know, and create world, you know...
Right.
Everlasting peace, you know, was really good.
Yeah, I misspoke. That was Moon Gwang, the housekeeper that's... Yeah, they're at that point they're sort of like blackmailing the Kims, and that's another, you know, the mention of nuclear war, especially with North Korea and South Korea. It's really interesting. What I was going to say though with the with Moon Gwang and her husband, that leads us into the notion in Parasite about the poor versus the poor in here. We talked about it a little bit because technically, what the Kims are doing is ousting people who already have jobs who probably would be exactly in the same situation as the Kims had they not had a job with the parks. And so the other thing is that that comes back to bite them when Moon Gwan comes back as the housekeeper and goes downstairs in the basement and gets her husband. And that kind of puts them at war with each other. You have the Kims who don't want to lose their position in this household because it's really the only thing that's making them money. And then you have Moon Gwan and her husband who literally can't afford to live anywhere else. They just want to like live downstairs. They don't want. Well, they don't really want anything else. Even they just want to be able to stay there.
Well, as I say, and you get to see again. Yeah, the poor versus poor. Because you get to see the ones in power at the time, like the other ones being like, you know, at first Moon Gwan's like, "Please, sister, you know, help me. I need help." And they're like, "Fuck you. We're calling the police." And then as soon as they're able to turn the table, she's like, "Well, now, sis, let's work this out." And she's like, "Fuck you. You know, this is what we're gonna do now."
You had that whole thing where they now the Kims don't even feel on the same playing field when they're working for the parks. As Moon Gwan, they literally feel a little bit superior, where she doesn't even want her to call her sis. And so, again, that just shows you, you know, that dynamic here. If you have the rich who really, you know, at first, they don't really experience any issues. You know, to them, what's a housekeeper? Doesn't matter who does it. As long as they're good at it and they can make
Ramdan,
it doesn't matter. But it's really the people that are underneath them that are getting paid and quite literally in this film, people that are underneath them living either in their basement or in the, you know, the whatever the sub basements that they have of semi basements. Those are the people that are really duking it out with each other for the opportunities.
And well, that's something. And I agree with what you're saying. That's something that's like probably one of the best moments for me in this film is because that's something you see. And we don't often get political on this show, but it's often something you see in like American society today. Living in the area that we live, you constantly see and hear people bitch about all the time. These motherfuckers on food stamps and welfare. Mm-hmm. I got a job. Why, you know, why do they got to, you know, get their lazy asses a job? When, like, that anger and divisiveness, you, like, you're misdirecting it because it's not at people who have any power to begin with or any real say, you know.
Yep.
They're not asking, like, how did that situation get created? They're just like, I got a fucking job. Why don't you have a fucking job?
Right.
You know, and then they usually have a come to, if, you know, and most of these people will eventually have, like, come to Jesus moments if they ever run into that situation where they're like, well, shit, you know.
Yeah.
But usually that come to Jesus only lasts for as long as they're in that situation. Yeah. And as soon as they're back out, it's like
back
to the status quo.
That is exactly what Parasite is showing.
Yes.
Is that you are in, so the Moon Gwan was in a great situation. She was as a housekeeper making good money with rich family. The Kims come along. They oust her from that position because there are a finite number of positions. Not everyone can have one. And so she's ousted. The Kims are in. Moon Gwan is out. Now Moon Gwan is upset with the Kims. But really, that doesn't, there's no power for either of them to say, boy, I wish we both could have jobs here, you know? It's one versus the other.
Well, and again, and I agree. And that also kind of, you know, goes back to, you know, how this film kind of is talking about just like, you know, this post-industrial, you know, capitalist society that we just about the entire industrial post-industrialized world lives in now. And an idea that I think a lot of people who don't know anything really about economics doesn't really understand. Like, again, going back to this, like, well, why don't they get a job? As long as there's supply and demand, there's always going to be a, you know, a finite amount of resources and jobs. Not everyone, you know, if everyone grew up to be fucking doctors, we'd be kind of fucked because there wouldn't be enough people to do other things. And as long as we have this tiered society of these different, you know, jobs that are valued at different things, there's always going to be people who inherently are going to be living in poverty because the job that they do is not going to be paid as, you know, amount that's going to be sustainable. Mm-hmm. And that's, again, you're always going to have people who are in poverty and don't have those jobs because, again, it's all like, you know, how much, if would that be worthwhile to you? You know, busting your ass, making $8 an hour at a job that does nothing for you compared to, you know, looking for something better.
Right.
And trying and using that time that you're giving up for something else. You may not be working, you may be on welfare, but maybe you're using that time to get a degree in something, to pursue a different job, you know.
And I think I think Parasite tries to show that too, especially at the beginning when they're showing them making the pizza boxes, that they literally are watching a YouTube video on how to fold pizza boxes as fast as possible so that they can make enough money to, you know, have like what would amount to be a useful job for them. And so it does show that the Kims are not people that aren't willing to work. And throughout this con job, it shows that they are really good at doing things. You know, they are really good at scripting and acting and art and being creative, and yet they still don't have those opportunities. So it's not about them not wanting to do something or not being, you know, not being skilled enough. It's about the opportunity itself not being available.
And that exactly, going back to like how I said, at first they seem like they're just a bunch of, you know, scummy con artists. Mm-hmm. That right there is what, you know, ties it all back together and how their environment and what opportunities they have is creating what they're doing.
Yeah. What do you think about the big birthday bash scene? The scene that really culminates, big climax sequence at the boys' birthday party.
That fucking kid did not deserve a party that lavish.
Yeah.
That, you know, to me, that mom was, she was full of shit. When she said that party's for his birthday, she got her titty twisted clockwise.
That's right.
And, you know, had a reach around, and she woke up feeling so great the next morning she's going to have a party to get all her friends over to drink wine and have hors d'oeuvres and just have a hell of a time. She didn't really give a shit about it. She's lying.
The other thing, too, is that she says that it's a... Was it a casual party?
Yeah, you can wear sweatpants.
Because it's an impromptu. You can wear sweatpants. I don't see anybody wearing sweatpants there.
No, they're all very finely dressed.
Nicely looking party. And even Kevin says that.
Asks if he fits in.
Yeah, because he just, you know, obviously doesn't look the part. And so, you know, that's interesting. But the part about the birthday bash that I was talking about is that whole climax where Moon Gwang's husband gets out of the basement, comes upstairs, grabs a knife. You know, basically starts a birthday party massacre at...
Well, if you've been in that basement for 4 years, you know...
And you just saw your wife die of a concussion.
Mm-hmm. And peach allergy.
Yeah. That peach allergy, which, I would say, again, is a pretty clever thing. I've never really heard of that, but I like the whole... The almost like... Ocean's 11 style.
I thought they were thinking of... at first, I thought they were talking about the daughter, and like I was like, what is this? Was like a metaphor for like... Because they were talking about Kevin being with her.
Right.
So I was thinking, like, is that, like, for a metaphor? Like, don't touch my daughter's vagina. Don't touch
the peach fuzz.
Yeah.
No, there's no peaches in this house. No, yeah, no.
But then it's like, oh, it's the... But no, you're right, because they're like, yeah, like, but that's also... Again, that's, like... I think out of all the con things that they do, that's, like the one of the most heinous ones they do. Like,
that's pretty rough,
because if she doesn't have, like, a fucking, you know, hypodermic needle, like an EpiPen to give her... What she needs is like, oh, yep,
yeah, the
she
died. Housekeeper twice has a terrible allergic reaction because of this peach fuzz that they're...
To simulate tuberculosis.
Yeah, that's pretty rough. But I thought it was clever.
Which, again, that's, you know, I did like that part, too, because when the father's talking to her about that, and because she's, like, having that reaction, like, really?
Mm-hmm.
The consumption? Still a thing?
Yeah.
You know?
Right. But... That whole birthday sequence is pretty great. And I think it's really tense when he's coming out, you know, after he's just bashed Kevin in the head with the giant rock. He's coming out with the knife and his face is all bloody.
It's like war paint.
Yeah. His face is all bloody. He's just coming out with this knife. And the whole scene really plays out well, and as expected, really, because he really just targets... The Kim family, because the biggest thing about this film is that the Kims really don't find themselves to be bad people. They think they're good people. They're doing what they need to do, but you know, that might have been bad, you know, getting the housekeeper fired and things like that. But they think that they're good people, and so
I don't know if they think they're good people, because by the end, at least with Kevin, he's very much questioning what the hell they've been doing. That is
true. Some of them are questioning what they're
doing.
And
I think his father is too.
Yeah,
because I think his father's. It's come to the realization, like, because they constantly talk about, we got a plan. Like,
yeah.
I've had all these plans my entire life, and it's got me to fucking conning these assholes and potentially killing two people in a basement.
But they do,
like, having that realization, like...
Yeah. The mom, Chung Suk, and how they keep bringing up the fact that, you know, oh, she's not much of a good person, she just kicked me down the stairs. And that becomes sort of like the mantra at the end for her husband, who's coming out and, you know, targeting these people who aren't good people. And, you know, it's a really exciting scene that is really the only, like, that and the bashing of the Kevin's head are the only explicit scenes in this movie. The only real violence that you see on screen.
Yeah, because even when the housekeeper goes tumbling down the stairs, ass over tea kettle, we don't really see, we just hear a crunk, you know, thud. Yeah. You know,
and actually, it's a very, you know how in movies, a lot of times, like, the thuds and stuff are, you know, like, meat getting punched?
Yeah.
Like, sound effects, Dolby sound effects and stuff? This was not. This is a very realistic, just thud. Like, just a normal, like, a fist hitting a wall. That's what it would sound like, to what I would assume. And I initially thought she was just dead right there.
Yeah, no, I did too. I was kind of surprised for her to be like, I got a concussion.
Getting
like,
up and
I'm like, sorry, you don't have a broken ankle and a wrist, you know.
Yeah. But, yeah, so that whole scene, you know, the stabbing and everything is great. But then you have, you know, the father, Kim, the father, who gets up and then instead of, you know, who you expect he's, you know, really pissed at, Moon Gwang's husband, he goes to stab Park instead because Park does that same sniff test of rolling over Moon Gwang's husband, smelling, being disgusted after he grabs the keys.
Well, you forgot the part too where they're waiting in the bush dressed as Native Americans.
Yeah, true.
Pop out to surprise you know, his son with a little Native American ambush as the cake's being brought out. You know, the father's talking to the Park patriarch, and he's like, you're about to cross that line. Don't cross that line. And just so you know, like, you're getting paid overtime, you know, so just do what you got to do.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's not like he wasn't invited, like, oh, the like, you know, yes, the employees and stuff are going to, he's like, hey, you're getting overtime, bud.
Right. That's another thing. You're not here because you are just invited to the family party. Yeah. You're not part of the family party.
Yeah, you're essentially part of the act. Like, you're part of this, you know.
Yeah. So,
that's because they make, you know, his daughter, you know, Jessica playing the art teacher, art therapist, like, they have her, like, no, come out, and you'll bring, because it's part of his art therapy, you'll come out and bring the cake out, you'll get paid extra, too, you know.
Yeah.
Like, it's regular one of your days, and...
Yeah. I think that culmination is really, really great.
I also think, too, though, that he doesn't just attack Park because of, like, the whole... I think when he sees, like, his son's got his head smashed in and the daughter that he's been tutoring is, like, hauling him off, you know, and his daughter's dying as he's, like, trying to compress, like, the wound, and his wife's about to get stabbed, and Park's just standing there like, we gotta get my son who only fainted.
Yeah.
You know, not mortally wounded or anything. He just fainted, and he's like, throw me the keys so we can get in the car and take him to the emergency room.
Not only that, but Chung Suk is fighting off a knife-wielding
man. He's like, they haven't even dealt with that yet. No, my son, I think the fact that he's, like, seeing, like, he's, like, as nice as they be, like, they only do not care. They only fucking care about, you know.
And literally no one at the party did.
No one.
Just ran away.
Yeah. I bet the people who are playing the cello and bass are just sitting there like, you know, dun-dun-dun-dun, you know, like...
That's another great moment where you see that divisiveness between the two where, you know, all they want to do, it literally doesn't even matter that someone's being murdered in front of them. We need to get my son to safety. That's the only thing that matters for them. Another really great.
So movie. I think that I like that touch of like that's like you know like showing like you know you don't give a damn I don't you know fine I'm only going to give a shit about you know what to do for my family you know.
I think I had did I have one other thing? Oh yes. So at the end of the movie, we find out that Kim, the father, has been living in the, obviously, in the basement of the house. after he kind of retreated there after killing Park. And he has been doing Morse code with the lights to try to write a letter to his son. And his son actually finds his Morse code and writes it out and figures out what he's been saying to him. And then he decides to write a letter back to his dad saying that he's going to make a lot of money, buy the house back, and then they'll all live happily ever after. And that's pretty much how it ends. And the only thing that you see is it shifts away from present time to what you would call a wish fulfillment future, where you see Kevin.
You could almost say it's neurosis at that point.
Right, right, yeah, because he also has brain damage.
Yeah, because you almost say like everything that happens after the hospital is him just in his own little happy world after getting his brain smashed.
And the only thing that you can't really
trust him as a narrator.
Because it comes back to him writing the letter, and so you can kind of estimate that never happened. Yeah. You know, that's not going to happen in the future. So what do you make of that? That it ends with him writing that letter and saying at the end, you know, I'm going to make a lot of money.
I think he's saying it in his head. I don't think it happened.
Right, no, and I even without thinking of whether it happened or not, like, what do you make of Bong Joon-ho ending the film with that letter saying, I'm going to make a lot of money, and I'm going
to
buy that house
back? Well, because that's, like, the idea that, you know, you're always told. Again, that goes back to, like, what we were talking about before, like, you know, like, if you just work hard enough, like, you know, that's why you hear people all the time bitching about people on food stamps. Why don't you have a job? Why aren't you working hard? If you got a job and worked hard, you know, we laughed about a meme we saw the other day, you know, of like, this is Jerry, he has no job and he's just leeching off the system. This guy, he's works 10 hours a day and he earns that 50 grand. And the CEO's been working 23 hours a day, never sleeps. And that's why he's got, you know, $7 billion, because he just pulled himself up by the bootstraps and kept working hard, working harder than everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
Again, not everyone can do that.
Yeah.
You can't have it, especially in a capitalist society. You can't have everybody be that. It's impossible. Resources are finite.
Yeah.
Everyone can be Jeff Bezos. So I think the idea, like, yeah, that's like what he's telling himself he's going to do. Mm-hmm. Is he going to do it? No.
Yeah.
Because, again, what did he do throughout this film to improve his situation? If anything, him and his mom are now fucked even more because they were, you know, tried for crimes. Luckily, only got probation out of, you know, forgery and all these other things.
Yeah.
But now he's, you know, they're technically convicts. And if you know anything about being here in America, being a convict, not really ever going to get you, you're basically fucked.
Yeah.
You know, unless you somehow become a successful entrepreneur, your opportunities are greatly stunted because of that. So his chances of ever, you know, achieving what his new goal now are slim to none.
Yeah.
But it's like I said, if you tie that into what I just said, that's great commentary.
I found it as, you know, as though Bong Joon-ho was writing it as like sarcasm, and that, like, yes, this is exactly, you know, everybody could just write it and do it, and you write it down and you do it. And, you know, as they've shown throughout the entirety of Parasite, you know, that's definitely not something that is impossible. Even the people that did work hard, you know, where did they get them? That poor cab driver.
He was handsome and good looking too.
Yeah, fired. And so I found it to just be like a nice sarcasm, a bleak ending to end it on, in that you know that that's not the future for
a happy kids. Ending would have done this film a great disservice.
Oh yeah, for sure. I do like how the film sort of morphs, and it's a black comedy for a particular span of time, but there is a point towards the end where it gets extremely serious. And sort of switches off from that black comedy and gets quite a bit more serious than, you know, it has been throughout the film. You can really feel that sort of shift, which I think works. I love a bad ending, like a, you know, bleak ending. I love those. So it's more realistic to me than something.
Yeah, we talked about that in the podcast. I do like some, even like it's staying, like even like some of the bleakest moments of them having like little humor. Even after the daughter's been stabbed, she's like, Dad, can you stop pushing so hard? It hurts even more.
Yeah.
As she's, you know, lying there bleeding out and dying,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like a nice little funny line. You know.
Do you like your nipple twisted clockwise or counterclockwise?
It's both.
I don't know if I've ever thought about it. Like, I didn't.
Well, when you're rich, you get to think about it. Like no.
I guess maybe it, like one thing that I do find, I think Parasite is meant to make you feel like their relationship, the Park's relationship, is sort of stilted. Like they don't have a great relationship together. And so that's why, you know, that whole scenario with them having sex is a little is thrown in there, because and how Kim keeps bringing up the fact that, well, at least he loves his wife, right? And I don't know that Parasite goes that far with that.
It did almost seem like at that point when they were talking in the cab about that, like it might almost be like maybe he's got a mistress on the side or right. something. Yeah,
I just felt.
But like they never delve into that.
It didn't go as far as I would like it to have with that, because sure, you can make that assumption, but there's really no proof or anything that.
No, I think for the most, I think for the most part, their relationship's fine. I don't really think it very well, like a lot of this, like again, like as we've been talking about, like some of the things they have, it's all veneer.
Mm-hmm.
So you could gain that, but I don't think either way, if you gleamed that their relationship's a facade or not, that it would add anything to the film.
Yeah, I felt like maybe that whole sex scene was supposed to be like they don't really know each other that well,
was
and
it,
so
was it even sex? It was just foreplay.
Oh yeah, it was actually.
They couldn't, we didn't
really,
see.
Couldn't really get down and dirty with
just a hand,
the possibility just that
some hands run out.
But yeah, I don't know.
They were really around in third, but they couldn't get home because the kid really, was out in his fucking tent.
Never really thought about the nipple twist too much, but.
I don't know. I did like that line though, just because it's just like you know. Like,
not only that, but the whole nipple feeling was sort of like out of nowhere. He just really like not even
out of nowhere. Of just started, boot, you know, just cop, yeah,
straight
just,
to the nipple,
and it's like,
boom. Must be. You know what? Maybe that's supposed to solidify the relationship. He knows what she likes, and he's just gonna get right down to it. The nipple twist. Oh. I think that's all I got. That's all my notes over here. Do you have anything to add about the film that we didn't talk about yet?
That's about it.
I think we covered quite a bit in very high critical fashion.
Rare.
Props on the back to us. Boop,
boop. Red took all my points for Vox.
Okay, so we got a rate Parasite. So, on a scale of 1 to 10 foofy dogs, because this film has 3 foofy dogs, one's even named, like, foof, something like that.
Fununu, Fukaku. I know, like, one's like a poodle, one's a cocker, like a spaniel, yeah. And what, I don't know.
Pomeranian.
Yes, yes.
Pomeranian. Yeah, and the name is foof. It's not foo-foo, even though the subtitle said it was foo-foo, but it's like, the way they pronounce it is like foo-foo. I don't know. But on a scale of three foofy dogs, out of scale of 10, I guess I would say 10 foofy dogs, what would you give Parasite?
I'd give it a 9. It's a really good film. More I'm kind of thinking about now, the more it's growing. Definitely liked it a lot. Was it the best film of the year? To be honest with you, I think it's the only one that got nominated that we watched. Well, that and Marriage Story. Yeah, Marriage Story is nominated, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, I didn't really watch that many Academy-nominated films this year. But I think it's very good. For a 2.5-hour film, it's, as Ryan said right in the beginning of the podcast, it seems frenetic and kinetic, but it's definitely got a very, I wouldn't say slow, but deliberate pace, because everything just kind of like just goes and goes, and the further on you go on the go throughout the film, it just builds and builds, and the pace picks up. I think a lot of the themes in the film are definitely resonant. If you have ever been a middle class, lower class person, or ever even lived in some form of poverty, definitely resonate with not just the United States or what life's like in South Korea now. I think it resonates. It's told in a way that can resonate with everybody,
mm-hmm.
You know, and if you've lived in that kind of situation, and despite what some people think, that's most of us. That's 95% of us. That's what we're living.
Mm-hmm.
So I think most people, you can glean something from that. And I think even though as rich as it is in its themes and motifs, It's definitely not hitting you on the head with it.
Yeah.
You know, I think even if you were the biggest dullard in the world and watched your films only for the sake of being a popcorn film, you could watch this film and glean things at surface value and enjoy the film. It's well shot. Even if you don't, you know, like reading foreign, watching foreign films because they have a different language, this film is greatly well acted. Everyone in here is delightful, very believable, and very emotional, especially the father. He has great facial reactions when you see, you know, foreground, background shots of him in the parks, you know, and like reacting to what they're saying about them. It's just a great, this is a great film. The hype that going into this, it's well deserved. Definitely, you know, I would say probably one of the best films I've seen in the past like 5 years.
Mm. Yeah, I would give it a 9 as well. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a really good movie. The way it moves through various themes and ideas throughout, I thought was outstanding. Really creative. I love the whole peach fuzz thing that they bring up. That's just a really weird detail that sticks out in this movie. And I really like the characterization that it goes into it, and the changes that come over you as you watch it, and the way that you feel about the Kims and the Parks sort of shifts over time, and you really don't know exactly who to be rooting for or against. That works really well. I think the theme itself is something that we really needed to see, especially, you know, South Korea. I don't really know the culture that well for South Korea. I assume from what I've seen in this movie, yes, they needed this movie just as much as America needs this movie. And, you know, what we've seen in the past few years politically, the climate is, you know, something that we needed to talk about. And I think Parasite was the perfect movie to do that with its themes. And you're right. You know, you really don't need to watch this movie and think about it critically. And you can still, you know, understand the elements that are going into it and what's happening and why, you know, why there is drama in the movie. But if you're looking at it critically, it has a lot of nuance to it that you can break down with its metaphors and symbolism. You know, and there's just a lot going on that gives it depth that, you know, some other films are lacking. So it's a really, really good movie. You know, it's one of those movies too that is dramatic and still fun. Like, I found this movie, so you can watch movies sometimes. I'm thinking of Revolutionary Road, which I don't know if you've ever seen that with Leonardo DiCaprio.
No.
That was a movie that I watched and ended up liking it, but I did not have fun in watching it at all. Like, and throughout most of the movie, I did not like the movie. I was like, this movie is fucking boring. This movie is boring. And then at the end of it, you were like, oh, that was a good movie. That's a movie that I would call not fun to watch, but still you like that movie. Parasite is a movie that's fun to watch and also a really good movie that, you know, has everything to it. And so that's really important to me, you know, when watching the film. So this is the film is great. Like you, I didn't see a whole lot of Academy Award nominated films this year. I don't normally anyway, but this year, you know, especially, yeah, you would think I would have, you know, what with Quentin Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in America and
Scorsese, yeah, the Irishman.
I didn't watch that.
Yeah, either. I'm ashamed I haven't seen him yet, yeah, either, but every time I'm like, 3.5 hours for the Irishman.
Yeah, right, right. Yeah,
three hours for Once Upon a Time.
Yeah. I'm surprised that I haven't seen those, but I didn't see a lot of them, but Parasite, easily one of the best films that I've seen this year.
Tarantino and Scorsese need to get together and decide, like, not to release films during the same
together
year.
Yeah.
Because they're both, like, you know, to be honest with you, I know Scorsese's only won one Best Picture, and that was for The Departed. He never won for Goodfellas or anything else.
Yeah.
And he's been nominated several times. I think Tarantino's never won Best Picture either.
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't think so.
So,
yeah.
You think one of these days, like Scorsese's like, yeah, I'm gonna get it one of these days. I'm gonna get it again. You know, but
he probably doesn't care.
I think
see him not caring.
No.
But.
And we didn't really talk about it too. This film is great with its photography too.
I talked a little bit about the
and it's symbolic too. Like, I think like the main, one of the main, like, not just the stairs, but also like when you like everything in the Park household is shot big. Open, vast, wide, like all this space. And then when you see like the Kim's sub basement, it's meant to really feel cramped, you know, and small and crowded.
under.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, like, it has a lot, like, if you're somebody who's really into the way films are shot, this one has a lot of great angles and interesting color palettes that, you know.
Yeah, cinematography being symmetrical, too, with the Parks house, and very busy with the Kims as well. So, yeah. Really interesting. Next time, what are we doing? Are we going to try to do Harley Quinn or
back to the ship?
Yeah. We did kind of fun at some point, and I don't know when, that we do Once Upon a Time in the West and then Once Upon a Time in America as a boop back to back.
We can do that.
That'd be kind of fun. I'm not saying we should do it next time or anything like that, but I'm saying, like,
are you ready to commit 8 hours?
Well, yeah, in total, over the course of 2 episodes.
Well,
yeah.
I was going to say, Once Upon a Time in the West is 3 hours.
Yeah.
Once Upon a Time in America, I think, is like 4.5 hours.
No, it's not that long.
Director's cut is.
Maybe. Yeah, no, I was just saying, like, we could do that at some point. That would be fun. I'm not saying we do that next week or next time. I think we probably will try to do Harley Quinn if it's still in theaters and if we can still catch it. So, yeah. Back to, I'm not going to say shit because I don't want to pre-bias myself.
No, it's shit.
But I can tell you that I'm basing my bias on is Suicide Squad. So if it's anything like Suicide Squad, I am not going to be impressed. So
I just want them to, like, stop parading her around in, like, hot pants. Like, stop.
I think they tried to do that. They tried to do that a little less in this one. I believe.
I know, but it just looks stupid. Like, stop.
No hot pants.
It just looks stupid. I know, like, it would probably kind of look stupid in, like how they shoot these to be realistic with her, like, wearing her, like, Harley Quinn suit, but that, to be, you know, looks cool. I like that, you know. Her parading around in hot pants and leather jackets, fucking retarded.
Yeah. All right, so we'll be back in 2 weeks with the Harley Quinn movie if we can see it in theaters. Thank you for listening to us ramble about Parasite. We are, as always, on pretty much any podcast app that you can think of. We're on iTunes, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, Podbean, pretty much anything. So subscribe to us, leave us a nice review. We are on Facebook at facebook.com/bloodandblackrum. We're on Twitter at bloodandblackrum. We have an email address at bloodandblackrumpodcast@gmail.com, and you can donate to us on our Patreon page at patreon.com/bloodandblackrumpodcast. And if none of those links work for you or you don't remember it, just go on Facebook, Twitter, or Patreon and search Blood and Black Rum Podcast, and you will find us there. Thanks for listening. We hope to see you back next time for our next episode in 2 weeks. And until then,
take care.